So a very good evening, everybody. I'm Skitter Fire. A very good evening and welcome to the first of our Industry Connect series called Bridging the Gap, where we bring students of hospitality and industry stalwarts together for an interaction. We are commencing the series with a gentleman who needs little introduction in hospitality circles, Mr. Vincent Ramos. Mr. Ramos is the Area Director, IHCL Goa, and the General Manager of the beautiful Taj Hotel and Convention Center at Dona Paula, Goa. Welcome to today's session, Mr. Ramos.
Thank you, Skeeter.
We have with us today a group of very enthusiastic students from the Institute who have some questions that they'd like to ask you. But before we commence, would you like to make a brief opening comment, Mr. Ramos, and then we go into the questions?
Sure. So good evening, everyone, and thank you, Skeeter. Thank you for the introduction. Aapne naam to suna hi hoga. My name is Vincent Ramos. I am from Goa. Okay, I come from this beautiful island called Shorao. And I did my schooling in Montigiri, you know, which was a boarding school. So all the naughty boys were put in that school in those days. Okay. Now, I don't know how the thing is, but in those days, if you're naughty in your family, you would be put up in the boarding. It's up on the hill. And they were about like some 600 boarders those days. And it was a tough life, almost like going through the army or navy or military life. Having said that, later on, I then went to science in Dempe College. And then Dempe College had a beautiful beach. So I landed up sitting on the beach all day long and not going to college. And then I was not interested in science because I thought that that's not my cup of tea, you know. And then hotel management was the option. And we were told it was very difficult those days to get into hotel management. Of course, I got into hotel management. And the rest was history after that. So I joined the hotel industry as a management trainee with the Leela Group. You know, and Leela had only two hotels those days. There was Leela in Goa and there was Leela in Mumbai. The Mumbai being the parent hotel. And Leela Goa was one of the hotels that was the only other hotel that they had. And somebody said that, oh, you're joining a two hotel chain. So I said, yes. But nevertheless, because those days, if you could not get into Taj and the Oberoi's, you know, your future is over. That means, and people wanted to commit suicide after the selection and things like that, that they have not got into Taj or the Oberoi's. But here I am as an area director of Taj. You know, when I went for the Taj interview, I was thrown out. And that is how it was, because I was very nervous, you know. And I learned from that, you know, that everybody makes mistakes in life. And there is, once you have to fail in life, you know. But if something is there in you, nothing can stop you. From Leela, I was called by the Taj and they said that after, I used to be a banquet manager, then a restaurant manager. And there was a gentleman called Mr. Ronnie Lobo, who was area director those days, which post I am holding now. He said that, you know, I think you are a Taj guy and you should join the Taj. And we are coming up with this new hotel called Taj Exotica Goa. Would you like to be on the opening team? And with a lot of hesitation those days, because again, you know, Leela used to have pride themselves as luxury and Taj that time was just the village. And somebody said that you're going to join those thatch roofed hotels. So I said, no, let me try this out. And I joined the Taj in 1999. And now it's been almost 20 years, two decades with the Taj. You know, I started off as assistant F&B manager. After F&B manager, I had a very nice boss, you know, who came in and she was very good. And she said, Vincent, you know, if you want to become a good GM, okay, you need to have, it's like playing tennis. You know, if you know forehand, you need to have a backhand. You need to have the knowledge of everything. And she told me another thing is that to be a good GM, you have to be jack of all trades and master of none. And that's what was a big mindset change for me. I said, jack of all trades and master of none. And now I understand that if you want to become a good GM, you should not be specializing in one field. You know, so you need to have the knowledge of everything. And she said that from tomorrow onwards, you are the accommodation manager of the hotel. You're going to be in housekeeping, overlooking front office, or vice versa. you could be in front office overlooking housekeeping. So I chose to be in front office overlooking housekeeping, and I was an accommodation manager. After that, I was a resident manager. And then came a time where they said that there was this property in on the backwaters of Kerala, which was a very boutique 28-room property. They said it's not doing well. We want to sell it. You know, we had just sold Tekri. We had a Taj Tekri property, and our managing director, vice chairman, those days used to be a Malayali Kerala, and he was very fond of Kerala. He said that, you know, I can't afford to start selling off properties in Kerala like this. You know, we'll be selling everything. And one of my bosses called Jamshed Dabu said, Vincent, why don't you give it a try? This is a property that is a sick unit. It's dying. You know, he said that I can see that in you. You know, maybe you can do something about it. He said, fine, you go and try. 6 months, if you don't succeed, we'll sell the property. Well, I went there. And, you know, sometimes if I have a little time, you know, and sometimes I feel that I should share this story of Taj Kumarakom separately to the students, because of the mindset that was, and people told me that, boss, everybody he's posted to Taj Kumarakom has left the company and gone. That's a punishment posting and things like that. But I said, no, my boss is telling me to go there. So I'm going on a different note. He said, no, but do you know what Kumarakom is? So I said, I know. He said, there are six unions there. You know, and yes, they did have six unions. So if I ever get a time, and if the college maybe one day invites me, I will show you a presentation of how I turned around Kumarakom. You know, that year, it took me exactly 18 months, you know, to turn it around. And I won the best turned around hotel for the Taj.
Wow.
That was one. Then I won the young manager of the year throughout India by board of NIPM, the National Institute of Personal Management. So I won a lot of awards for turning around and making it a profit-making hotel. Today, as of today, as I talk, Taj Kumarakom makes more profit than a Taj Western Bangalore. So that's how it is. So it's a different topic altogether. One day, probably I want to share what is the secret, how the mindset should be of a person, how that everything in life, you don't get it easy. You know, sometimes it's not about a brick and mortar hotel, but sometimes it is the paddy fields and the trees that you can play around with and start selling a hotel on that concept and make it the best hotel, you know, in whatever way. My fame so far is the best hotel of the world that I won. As if you Google best hotel of the world 2016 by TripAdvisor, I was the GM of Umaid Bhawan Palace. And that's where that's when I my boss told me, you know, now that you have won the best hotel of the world, you know, and you know, on TripAdvisor, which is, you know, it's the comments of all the valuable customers, not that some Condé Nast or some whatever Travel and Leisure or whatever it is, you know, but it is because they are genuine comments that comes. And since you have won that, and this is the most authentic award, he says, what do you want? And I said, I want to go back to Goa. So he gifted me this thing that, you know, I came back to Goa, and here I'm sitting down and talking to you as the area director of Taj Goa or IHCL Goa.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Ramos. You've taken us back in time through the journey that you've been on for so many years. And we see that every time that opportunity presented itself to you, you took that leap of faith and made it a success. And we'll remember about inviting you back to talk about the story behind Taj Kumarakom. So now before I won't take any more time, we'll go straight to the questions. We have a question from Esther Jacob. Esther, you'd like to ask your question?
Yes.
Hi Esther, good afternoon. You're from Kerala?
Yes, I'm from Kerala.
What part of Kerala?
I'm from Kochi.
Oh, proper Kochi.
Not proper, in Tripuntara,
where the palace is.
Yes, sir.
I was posted there for 5 years, you know, and Kochi, I was GM of Taj Malabar Kochi.
Yes, sir.
For 3 years.
My name is Esther Jacob, and my question for you today is, what was your first job in the hospitality field, and what have you learned along the way up until now?
There's a lot that I've learned, Esther. You know, I am now 53 years of age, almost 30 years of experience. And I think without a fall, no child learns to walk. That is what I've learned. And that's what I want to tell you young students, that you have to fail in life. You have to fail in life. You cannot get everything. There are no shortcuts in life. But yes, you make a mistake, but don't make it a second time. You know, you have to learn from that mistake, you know. So my whole thing was, I think my family in those days thought that I failed in life when I dropped out of science, you know, or I didn't like science and I wanted to do hotel management. And everybody said that, oh my God, what is this guy? Nobody wanted to associate. None of my family members wanted to get associated to me, because in my family, there were other cousins who are engineers or doctors and things like that. And the fact is that that these same engineers and doctors don't even earn, I'm not boasting about myself, you know, don't even earn about less than, I mean, 1/4 of the salary, you know, of what I'm earning. I'm not saying that, but probably that was how it was, that if you were an engineer or a doctor, you know, you would get fame, of course. But you would also get a lot of money. And then, you know, all the girls would want to get married to you, right? You know, if you had a proposal in your village those days, and so somebody said that you're working in a hotel and there's an engineer next door in another house and a doctor, the proposal would have gone to them, right? But India has come a long way, right? And that's why I want to speak to young minds like you, that don't lose faith. You know, you have it in you. You have chosen the right direction. You know, this is the future of the world. The hospitality industry is, yes, we are in the pandemic time, but pandemic is going to get over. Have faith in God. You know, maybe God wanted to teach us this lesson, that he wanted to pinch us and say that, hey, listen, I'm there, you know, and that's what's happening, because people have started forgetting God somewhere. And it doesn't matter what religion you belong to. But yes, we have to be aware that there is a mighty force. Have faith. And things will fall in place. And you all have a future to go to. And yes, coming back to your questions, I have failed many times. I have failed not once. You know, probably I failed, many jobs that I was given, you know. But I can give you examples of so many things, you know, that I have failed. But the good part is that I realized later in life that I needed to fail that time, because if I had not failed that time, you know, I wouldn't have been what I am today. You know, today I can walk around, and talk to people and tell them that what they're doing is wrong, and tell them that what they're doing is correct, you know, because of my experience. So I think that is what is the beauty of life, that you need to fail. And there are a lot of jobs that I took over. I took over as a banquet manager. I failed. Probably as a F&B manager, I failed. But I was quick enough to understand where I failed, and that fail became a lesson to me, you know. So there is this saying that when you lose, don't lose the lesson. So I think that's what is important, and one needs to fail in life. So to coming back to your questions of what was my first job? My first job was, I started off as a management trainee in Leela, okay, and my first job was an assistant manager banquets.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Hope I've answered your question. Yeah.
Pooja Mulle, you'd like to go next?
Good evening, sir. Good evening. My name is Pooja Mulle and I'm from New Delhi.
Right.
I am a first year student at VMS IIT. So my question to you is, which is the one most important quality that will help us succeed in this industry?
The most important quality that will help you succeed not only in this industry, but in every industry or as a human being, and what I call is attitude, a positive attitude. It is your attitude that is going to define your altitude. Okay. If you have the right attitude, it doesn't matter how you look. You might, you know, you might say, oh, I'm not good looking, or I think that people think that way. No, it's not about that. Or how short you are, how tall you are, how fat you are, how thin you are, doesn't matter. People get better. I said, don't worry about all these things. That this is human, right? We are human. It is the right attitude that will make you successful. And to answer your question, there's only one answer to it is attitude.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sarah Miranda, you'd like to go next?
Good evening, Mr. Ramos. My name is Sarah Miranda. I'm from Goa. My question to you is, you've expressed your love for horticulture and have mentioned that you have a personal hand to play when it comes to taking care of the lush gardens in Taj Exotica. Can you tell us about your love for horticulture?
I think very nice question. Horticulture was one of the quality, or my love for horticulture was one of the qualities that brought me to this stage, I would say, because that's where, when I went to Kumarakom, you know, people called me GM, and my secretary came and said, sir, you know, what is the full form of GM? I said, no, she was joking with me. She said, garden manager. So I said, because I spend a lot of time in the garden. Okay. If you have the time, Google this property, Four Seasons Chiang Mai. They have two buffaloes and paddy fields. Okay. When a person becomes rich, what does he do in the end? He buys a farmhouse, correct? Because he wants to come back to nature. We do not understand this simple philosophy of God-given thing called nature. Nature is luxury, okay? Today, if a chef is cooking your food, your mother cooks food, you know, it's about those fresh beans. It's about whatever the micro things that they do, they germinate or whatever it is. It's all about the plants, the horticulture around you. So you should not forget that subject. You know, it is one of the most important thing. It's the flowers outside your room, also the things that you put in your food. It's the basil. It's the lemongrass. So horticulture is one of the subjects that is neglected in the hotel industry. And I was speaking to your principal and I said that you should have a subject on horticulture. When you become a general manager, you should know what are the plants that grow in the shade. There are some plants that grow in the shade, some plants that grow in the sun. What are the endemic plants? What are the exotic plants? Endemic plants, because plants that grow in your own country, you know, in your own state. You don't have to water them because they are meant to be like that. God has made it like that. You know, a vadilia, which is there in the garden, you don't have to maintain it, but it gives you a lovely flower. It gives you that cover for green grass. So horticulture is a vast subject. We take it for granted, but this is the most important subject for hotels. The one thing that I did was when I went to Kumarakom is that I took all the gardeners to my neighboring hotel called Kumarakom Lake Resort. I said, I put them in a boat because, you know, Kumarakom is all waterways. So I put them all in a boat. So these guys have never been to a five-star hotel before. So I told the HR manager, I want to take all the gardeners out for a lunch. And I want to take them to this particular hotel because I believed the horticulture of that hotel was very good because they wouldn't understand Malayalam. I could not communicate to them. Okay, how do I communicate what I want in life? So I said, okay, let's do this. You know, let's take them all out for lunch. So they all came like dressed like heroes. They all had that mund. You know, mund is the lungi. You know, not the lungi, the cheap lungi, but the mund. They all came. I was like, oh my God. And they were all there. And they were all, I said, let's go to this hotel. And I just pointed out certain things to them. They understood me. They understood my language. They understood my body language, whatever. They could not understand probably the English I spoke. And neither I could understand this Malayalam there because they're all poor people. And, you know, they're very good attitude. And I said, I want to make the hotel I mean. By the way, I forgot to mention about the hotel I was in is that we measure the hotels in the scores, guest satisfaction scores. The guest satisfaction scores was 24%. Okay. When I left the hotel, it was 90%. Okay, that was how it was. So that's why it was a turnaround. So we have this NPS. So you will understand what is NPS if you Google on the net, okay, net promoter scores or how it works, right? 24% and how it became 90%. You know, so I think horticulture plays a very important role in hoteliering. And if you want to become a good general manager, which you all are aiming for, I'm sure, and you have to become, you know. And I know a lot of chefs also want to become, general managers for the future when they're in the cooking university and things like that. But even for chefs, horticulture is very, very important, you know, because they have to understand the microgreens and whatever it is, how it is, you know. And it's a very interesting subject. And I think each one of you should pay a lot of interest of what are the types of flowers, what are the types of grasses, you know, what are the types of, there's Mexican grass, this dhoop grass, this grass, that grass, buffalo grass, all. You have to understand all that thing. And it does make that subject very, very important in your life.
Thank you, sir.
I hope I answered the question.
Yes, sir, you did. Thank you.
Saloni Bandurga, you can go.
Good evening, sir. My name is Saloni Bandurga. I'm from Pune. So my question to you was, the next step is considered as management training. So what if a student does not get through management training? Can we still climb the social ladder of hospitality?
Good question. And a tough question also to answer. And I understand where you're coming from. And what if you don't get as a management trainee? And I think if you don't get as a management trainee, that's the best thing that can happen. Because then you step down one level lower, correct? And you start understanding the nitty-gritties, okay? It is like this, you know, it is when you are a manager, you're a general manager yourself, correct? You do understand you start empathizing, you know, if you've been a cook. Okay, by the way, before I became a management trainee, I had gone through all this drill of, you know, peeling 200 kilos of onions and, you know, all that thing when I used to, you know, have my pastime or, you know, sometimes even for 6 months, I worked in a Chinese kitchen, for example. So I can make very good Chinese food, having said that, you know. But then management training came to me as whatever, you know, it was not. But I know a lot of people get demotivated when they don't get as management trainees. But I can tell you, I've been in this industry, you know, for 30 years. Many people who have got into management trainees have failed in life. But the people who are below management trainees have now reached there because probably they understood the nitty-gritties of the guy who washes the dishes, the guy who peels the onions, or the guy who serves on the table. Because when you become, after the management trainee, what's your next posting? Your manager. Okay. Now, the question is, when you are a manager, if you don't start empathizing with people down the line, you know, that's wrong. And you think that you've now got a quote and you can boss over you, but people laugh behind your back. And that's the worst thing that can happen to you. So if you're a management trainee, it's good, but don't forget that you will not be, even if you're a management trainee, you will not be successful as a manager. Don't take it for granted unless you have gone. That's why I encourage all the trainees in the hotel. I spoke to some of the boys, you know, the other day I was speaking to David from your college. You know, I was telling him how it is, you know, David, I said, this is the time you need to roll up your sleeves and learn everything, because tomorrow, if you become a management trainee, you'll never get this opportunity of rolling up the sleeves again, probably, and learning the things that you learned in this time, you know, mopping the floor. Because today as an area director, if I start telling people that I want to learn how to mop a floor, people will say, oh my God, what is this? You know, this guy has become an area director without knowing. But when I walk by on my rounds and there's a guy mopping and I tell him you're mopping wrong, he looks up to me, he says, you know, nobody in this 20 years have told him that he's mopping wrong probably. But I tell him that this is the correct way. And then his respect grows for the person. So he says, oh, this guy knows the job. And I tell him that, you know, why are you using this broom? This is bad for your ergonomics. Why are you not using the other broom? You know, because that is good. Because why are you putting this band? You know, like, for example, I give you a gardening, you know, you bend and you take those hard brooms and you sweep. But if you see on the streets of Mumbai, you have that big stick, you go like that with a broom. It's good for the guy also, you know. So you need to have a knowledge so of everything. And this knowledge, it comes to you only when you do it yourself. If you have broomed and you know how painful it is to, you know, sweep a room, you know, then you understand that, you know, you need a right broom to sweep the room. So it is important, you know. Don't forget that management training means, you know, that you'll never become a manager. No, you're only probably delaying your future. I'm not saying delaying. I would say you're actually this thing by 1 year, because you'll become a manager anyway. But the day you become a manager, you'll be a good manager. Let me put it this way. You are probably all say 25 years old, correct? You retire at 60. How many years do you have in the industry?
35
years, right?
Yeah.
You have to spend 35 years in the industry, right? So what's the hurry? Why do you want to become a GM in a hurry? Okay, you become a GM at the age of 35, or you say you're at the age of 30. Then what? Then after that, what? You're going to work as a GM or probably whatever it's for another 30 years? So let life have its own formula. Everything will fall in place. Don't be in a hurry. Don't be, you don't want to become a GM at 30. I know a guy who was made a GM at 28 and he was then put up because of his God, oh, the youngest GM of a company. And then one fine day, what happened? He failed so miserably. Today, he can't even show his face because he's moved out of the industry. So you don't want that to happen, you know? You don't want that to happen to you. You want, there is no shortcut in life. Hard work never goes out of fashion. I want to repeat this. There is no shortcut in life. Okay, you cannot take a shortcut and say that, oh, listen, that guy was my classmate. Look at him. He's now a supervisor. I become a manager. Wait for 10 years. That guy will be the best vice president and you'll still be a housekeeper. Having said that, I had a classmate of mine. First year, first in college, every year. You know today what he is? He's a housekeeper. So that's the fact of life. And I'm not saying that because it is not that all the time you like a bookworm going to notes and doing and studying and get a first out of first every year, first out of first. No, that's not it. There's more to life. There is more to life than books. You have to be naughty. You don't take life so seriously. You need to play around a little bit. You need to experiment around. You need to experience life as it life. Don't take life so seriously. Okay, so I hope I've answered your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Great, great advice there, Mr. Ramos. Tassi Tavares, you can go next.
Good evening, Mr. Vincent Ramos. I'm Tassi Tavares. And I'm from Dubai. I completed my certificate course in culinary arts at DCT in Dubai. And presently, I'm in my first year with VM Salgaonkar Institute. My question to you, Mr. Vincent Ramos, is within the industry, the kitchen is mostly a male-dominated area. I'm keen to being a chef. Being a girl stepping into this domain, what are your views and advice for me? And if I was to be hired as a chef in your hotel, what would you expect from me during the first few months?
In your house, who's a better cook, your mother or your father?
My mother.
Okay. So that you have, thank you. You've answered my question. Ladies make the best chefs, the best cook in my opinion. That's why your mother is the best. Men probably are forced into it or you know, we this thing. But for a woman, it comes naturally. Cooking comes naturally. It's part of their life. It's only that they don't get paid for it, correct? But men get paid as a celebrity chef and all. Probably all our mothers are celebrity chefs, correct? And we should not forget that. And I still, you know, we have worked in the hotel industry or so, but still that mother's food, your wife's food is still the best. I hope you all agree with me.
Yes.
So having again said that, you know, I want to assure you that the male-dominated world was there. It's a passing phase. It will be soon gone, right? At the Tatas or at the Taj, we have this empowerment for women, and we treat everybody equally. You know, we have some of the finest general managers for women now, and respect. You know, it's what is needed. You know, and that's why I think people feel that they are, you know, male dominated world. There's nothing like a male dominated world. You can be the change. You change. When you are there, you know, you should be able to change, bring out the qualities. You know, I was watching this movie the other day about that girl in that when she joined the Air Force. You know, they didn't even have the toilet, you know, because it was a man dominated. Mm-hmm. Only when, what was that movie? Sorry. Some nice.
Gunjan Saxena.
Gunjan Saxena. Yeah. I think it's a good movie, you know, and how she changed the perception of people. So I think all of you have to become Gunjan, you know, for the world to change. It's nothing like man, male dominated. It's all in your mind. Who says so? It's male dominated. If you allow male to dominate over you, yes, of course, male will dominate over you. But if you don't allow them, they will not. It's up to you. And you need to learn this at an early stage. Yes, for you to become successful, what you need is passion. Is that passion for your job, for the chef, innovation, passion. And whatever you do, do it from your heart. You will never, ever go wrong. Never, ever. Trust me. And if you ever do this, and if you fail, then you come back to me. You can never fail. You just need to be hardworking. As I've said, no shortcuts. You need to have the passion. You need to have the attitude. You can never go wrong. There's nobody that I know of who have gone wrong if you have these qualities with you. Tessie, are you there?
Tessie.
Yeah, okay. So I hope, again, I managed to answer your question. Or is there anything more that I can, would you like to know?
No, sir. Thank you, sir.
All the best to you, Tessie.
Purva Sharma, you'd like to go next?
Good evening, sir. My name is Purva Sharma and I'm from Maharashtra. My question for you was, Goa has stood out as a solid market and hospitality sector. What do you feel is the reason behind this?
Thank you, Purva. Goa, when it comes to Goa, because I have been to many of the places all around the world, there's something nice about Goa. Goa is a land which we call the Parshuram's land. It was, you know, it was, the arrow was shot and Goa was created. We as Catholics believe that Goa is blessed because we have the body of Saint Francis Xavier. Having said that, I don't think so there is any other balanced place as good as Goa, you know, or probably there are, you know, but Goa tops the market. It's sad to say that Goa is, you know, in a way, filthy, dirty with plastic and things. But if you take it out, you know, if you take out everything and if you just, you know, minus all the garbage problem around, Goa is always stood out. And I've been to places and I've said, you know, they told me that this is the beach. I said, no, but we have better beaches than in the USA when I was in, I think, the Orange County. They said, this is the beach. I said, no, but we have better beaches than Goa, you know. So I think Goa is blessed. You know, it's a nice place. Now, coming to the markets and to everything, so when a place like Goa is there, which excites every market, you know, whether it's a wedding market, whether it is a single traveler, whether it is a group, whether it's anything, everybody wants to head to Goa. The warmth of the people are also nice. Of course, the population is fading now because many of them are going back to Europe. I mean, going to Europe, not back to Europe, but going to Europe. But Goa has its own strength, you know. If minus the dirt part of it, the other is, Goa is a beautiful place, you know. It has got the nature's grace, you know. One day I had gone to Switzerland, I had gone to Davos, and they created all these palm trees and everything, and they paid a fortune. I said, oh my God, I didn't realize this, that how beautiful Goa is. They created the coconut trees and everything that what we have in Goa there for a theme night. And I said, wow, people are so excited. They were merrymaking, you know, amidst that snow and things like that. So Goa will always remain on the top. It is our responsibility to keep Goa clean. It will always excite any tourist. You know, this is a good example during pandemic. Everybody's heading only to Goa. There are so many other places. You know, there are so many other places in India. But you see that Goa is doing extremely well because it's blessed with the people, with the food, with the culture, with the heritage, and naturally blessed. So Goa will do well, and Goa has the potential and will always remain like this.
Thank you so much, sir.
Ashley Rodericks, you're on next.
Good evening, sir. My name is Ashley Rodriguez.
Yeah, I thought it was a female-dominated world. Suddenly you see a male now.
I'm happy to see all
the females, you know. I thought it was not good. Ashley, how are you?
I'm good, sir. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Yeah, so my name is Ashley Rodriguez. I'm from Goa, but I'm currently living in Dubai, and I'm a final year student at VM Sivakakis. So my question to you is, what does Taj or IHC look for in a candidate when they're hiring?
We hire for attitude. Nothing else. We don't, and I don't want to mince my words, and I don't want to complicate the situation. I can ask you 10 questions, and I know that, you know, that you'll not be able to answer. And that's what a lot of people say, oh, they hire them for knowledge. No, knowledge will come automatically. What we are looking out is the right attitude, and we hire for attitude. That's it.
All right, sir. Thank you, sir.
Next up, we have Mavish Fernandez.
I'm a third year student. I'm from Goa, but currently residing in Abu Dhabi. And my question for you is, what do you like to do when you are not at work?
Good question. What do I like to do when I'm not at work? I like to do gardening. So gardening. And so you see, when in everyone, and I want to be very truthful to what I'm saying, you know, and I don't want to give you a fake answer. My life has become so hectic now that I hardly have any time. Okay. So the real answer would be today that I would like to sleep whatever extra time I get, because that's very important in one's life. But yes, when I was just an HOD, you know, and I had a lot of time, I would get these 2 days off and things like that. I would actually do gardening. That was my passion, and I think it will remain a passion. And I've learned a lot, because people might think that it's a very silly thing, but I think it's very, very important. For the love for the nature is very important, and I want to maintain that.
Thank you, sir.
Kiara Pereira, you can ask your question, Kiara.
Good evening. My name is Kiara Pereira. I'm a student of the first year. And my question to you is, what did you do differently as compared to your colleagues to reach the position that you are in today?
I didn't do anything differently. I just thought that I should do my duty. And if I started differentiating or start competing with somebody, I wouldn't have reached where I am. Because I would have been, if I start competing with somebody, then probably if that person had won the game, I would have felt very demotivated, and I would have not reached where I am. So I just kept on doing what I have to do in life, you know. But there's one thing that I would love to do also, and probably I'm now lacking a little bit, is to be a human being, a good human being. When I say that, you know, today I don't have the time. Today I was thinking there was a birthday of somebody, you know. There was a time that I was to call that person to my office, wish him, give him a gift, you know, and wish him and ask him how you are. And even when I was less busy, I used to sit down and have a lunch with such people, you know. But that's what it is. I would like to have the real human connect with my people, you know, and that's what I want to be different. I think everybody, you know, values the chair, the power. But I think if you genuinely help somebody in trouble, and if you genuinely connect to people, and I always know that everybody has some problems. And if you think, if you can give them a good advice, I think that's the best thing that you can do. I know so many people that I know of that come from, you know, broken families that I would love to help, you know, mentor them, show them the right this thing, because they behave in a very different way, and tell them that it's part of life. You know, there's nothing much, but you have a future in front of you. And I still take the time to do this, you know, I like to do a lot of charity. I like to do a lot of social work. I would like to go to old age homes. I would like to go to orphanages. I want to be different that way, you know. But that's not what I am. But I think that is one quality I want to be different from other, because today everybody's become so selfish. Everybody's become so inner to himself. It's me, I. And I want to do that. And I sometimes feel that because of doing things this way, that I'm blessed and I've reached this position.
Thank you so much, sir.
Pleasure. You know, when I was in Jodhpur, the king told me, Vincent, there's something that is called dua that you get if you do good. And that is what I want to get from people, you know, the blessings of the people. And the blessings, like you take the blessings from your elders. And I think that's the main thing in life.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ramos. Next up, we have Brandon Gabriel.
Good evening, sir. My name is Brandon Gabriel. I'm from Goa itself. My question for you is, sir, from all the places you have been to, which place holds the closest place in your heart and why?
So, of course, it's Kumarakom. Because that was the place that I lived without my family. That was a place that is tucked away somewhere in the corner. I was a general manager, but I used to travel by bus for 2 hours from Kochi. You know, I used to change the bus at Chertala. You used to take 2 buses to get there. But the people, you know, it's always that the people, if you go to Kumarakom today, And if you tell them that you're from Goa, immediately they'll say, do you know Vincent Ramos? You know, so that is how it is. Because I think when you touch the hearts of people, and I think that place is very, very, because they're very simple people, you know, very, very simple people. It's nice that you start relating to them. There was this painter who was painting. And so I got talking to him and I asked him, what have you studied? And I thought that he would say SSC, you know, but I was surprised that he was MA, you know. So they're simple people, probably they studied, but they do not have those luxuries. I'm not talking about the village and I'm not talking about Kochi. I'm talking about this village called Kumarakom, you know, on the backwater, small houses. And that's what it is. I like that place very much. Is blessed. It's really, really blessed by nature. Have you read the book, The God of Small Things? Is written on Kumarakom.
I will read it.
Sorry?
I will read it now, sir.
You must. It's by Arunmati Roy. It's one that award, The God of Small Things.
Thank you, sir.
We have two more students to go, Mr. Ramos. Next up, we have Giselle Silvera.
Hi, sir. Good evening. My name is Giselle Silvera, and I'm a final year student at BMSL Gangkar. I'm based in Kuwait, but originally from Goa. So today, my question for you is, when you were a student, do you have any fond memories that stand out the most?
Okay, now tell me, now you're based in Kuwait, so you are training there, or...?
No, I was living over there with my parents and I've come down for further education in Goa.
Oh, okay. Okay. So the fond memory that stood out the most was my chef competition. You know, so there is to be this chef competition in those days. I'm talking about 1989. Chef. If you could get into the chef competition, you know, you were like the star, okay? And you had to do a lot of trials and all that thing to get into this competition. And finally, there was this HOD of mine, Mr. Rob Dickles, he walks up to me and says, Vincent, you've been selected for the chef comp. And I think that was the best memory that happened. Of course, we went to Lucknow for this because it used to be an intercollegiate all national level. And I won a silver medal. For that. Apart from that, all the naughty things that we did in college, so are very, very memorable also. We used to bunk and we used to go for movies, and we used to have a lot of fun, you know. But that's, as long as you don't hurt anyone, you know. I'm not saying that, you know, you should not hurt anyone. You know, if you're bunking, it should not hurt your elders. It should not hurt your principal. It should not hurt anyone, you know. But you need to be naughty, but with to an extent, you know. And you should not, you could not be very serious too. As long as you're not hurting anyone, even when you're playing a prank on somebody who's not hurting somebody, I think you should do it, you know, because that's part of life. But if you're hurting somebody, then please don't, you know. But that's how it is.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Pleasure.
And we have the last student coming up, Krishan Agarwal.
Hi, sir. Very good evening to you and everyone present here. So my question for you today is, as you earlier said, you were the general manager of Umaid Bhavan in Jodhpur. Could you just share some more of your experience and how did you get to that? How was it managing the world's greatest hotel at one point of time?
Krishan. You have a
Krishan.
Right?
Yeah,
Krishan. Okay, yes, sir. Krishan. So after my Kumarakom days, where I was posted, you know, my boss those days, Mr. Abhijit Mukherjee, said that I'm going to give you a double promotion. I said, what is double promotion? He said that I will send you to a hotel from a 28-room hotel to a 100-room hotel. So he posted me to Taj Malabar Kochi. After that, in that Taj Malabar Kochi also, you know, was an okay hotel. It was a nice hotel, but we did something and we won some lots of awards that year, which were, you know, we used to have this TABE Awards, Taj Excellence Business, Taj Awards for Business Excellence, you know, Tata Awards for Business. So we won those. And then he said that I will send you to luxury hotels. So then came the Umaid Bhavan break, you know, the luxury hotels. And then I won that best hotel of the world by TripAdvisor. So that's how it is. But it's very, very interesting that that every hotel I have been to, you know, had a different chemistry and a different setup. But I really enjoyed what I did in Umaid Bhavan. I always, as a general manager, played around with what was the available resource. You know, I never, as a general manager, and I tell this to my people also, you know, it's like your house, you know, it's your mother. Whatever she'll cook with, whatever is there, you know, there, okay, there's dal, there's fish, okay, there's wine, there's a bread, okay, she'll cook that thing. You can always have a fancy wish list and say that I want this, I want that, and I want this, and I want to create something. No, I think it's the trick is always to work within the means that you have. You know, you cannot go to your bosses and say that, hey, listen, I want to, get this, then only I'll perform. Or I want this and I will perform. No, you need to understand this in life in an earlier thing. You know, when I was in Kumarakom, for example, I played around with the five senses, okay? And I carried these five senses right to even to my Umaid Bhavan days. When I say five senses, the welcome. I said, when you are welcoming a guest, you should meet all the five senses. So what I did was, that every welcome that happened in Umaid Bhavan, there were drums and bugles played, so people could hear. Then I made somebody put the itar, because it was a palace. And it was like this. To enter the palace, even today I think is there, you need $100 to enter the palace. Okay. So I said every experience has to be a wow. So we got the drummers, the bugles. Then there was something called chadar, you know, that they do, they have the chadar, the Surya Vansa chadar. And so,
yeah, it's some Rajasthani kind of a thing, right?
Yeah. If you type Google on this thing, you see the welcome at Umaid Bhavan, you'll see what I'm talking about. That was all created by me. So I said it has to meet all the five senses, you know, it has to meet, there should be a nice perfume around when you check in, there should be some good music to this thing. So everything I wanted, the sight, the whatever you hear, whatever you touch, you know, of course you're given a champagne at check-in, you know, so everything on those lines. So the same thing I did when I was in Kumarakom, that you need to play with the five senses. I said that in Kumarakom, you can see a lotus bloom, you can taste wild honey, you can hear a cuckoo. So I wrote the welcome letter that way, that it is different from others. Hearing a cuckoo, seeing a lotus bloom, tasting wild honey, which is not usual in other hotels. So always I had the five senses. Then also in the night, for example, in the Kumarapuram around the lake, I used to have this village ladies come and put 1,000 diyas around the lake. And I had this Akash, Vayu, Jal, Bhumi, Agni. When you have these five elements around you, your soul is at peace. So everybody, neighboring hotels from Kumarakom came to Taj to watch this experience. So 10 ladies would come from the village. I used to pay them 70 rupees, per day. 10 ladies came, 700 rupees. I would create this experience. So, and if you, again, it might be there on Google, the diya lighting at Kumarakom around the lake. They would come, they'll put all these diyas. So there was Akash, there was Jal, the water, there was Bhumi, there was Agni, which was the fire. So, and when you have all this, so you need to understand that hoteling is much more than what you think of. You get my point? You need to get to that human element, the Indianness, you don't have to go to Cornell and pass out to understand this. I know people who have been to Cornell and have failed in life. And Cornell is supposed to be the finest, in hospitality. I know them. I can give you examples. I know the names. They've been there because they had the money. They would go there. But you have to understand, as a human being, you can make the change sitting there, just having the right mindset. You are in a great college, I can tell you, because your college is just right. It's not overdone and it's not under. You're just right. Your principal is good. Your administration is good. It's just there. And that's the way a college should be. It should not be over the top and it should not be too below also. So I think you are in the right hands, and you all people have a bright future. I can assure you that. My only job is to tell you that have a right attitude in mind, have a positive mindset, you will succeed. Trust me, you can read my lips.
Thank you so much, sir. I believe everyone on the panel also must have loved your experience. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Krishang.
Thanks. Thanks, Krishang. And thanks, Mr. Ramos. You let us into your life and gave us many goosebump moments today. Chef, so we are done with the students and they got to ask the questions that they wanted. Chef, do you have a question or a comment?
Yes. Good evening, Mr. Ramos. And on behalf of all the VMS IIHE team, and the students, it's my privilege to express my gratitude what you have shared with our students. The inspiration, especially to the naughty students, I think it's good. you gave that feeling which maybe a lot of students may go through when it's not running as they have expected, maybe, or had put the pressure on themselves, or had got pressure on themselves from outside, and when sometimes things don't work like they should work, not to give up, to see it as a stepping stone. And I read a very nice thing the other day, the stone which is in your way, you should not fall over it, you should just step on it, enjoy the view, and then continue your walk. And that is actually a nice thing, and it says a little bit what you have said. So I thank you very, very much for all your time. Since you have already short time, I hope you enjoyed it more than sleeping for the little time you have. And thank you as well, Skitter, and thank Mr. Vernon for putting all this up, and Edna, of course, to make this all happen. And it is really something beautiful for us. You never have time normally to sit together like this, and especially in this state. So thank you very, very much for your
thank you, Chef.
Mr. Ramos, on behalf of the students and faculty members of VM Sir Gaonkar, I would like to thank Mr. Vincent Ramos for taking the time out of his schedule and gracing us with his presence for this interactive session that was helpful to us all. I would also like to thank our esteemed Professor Mirza for providing us with this opportunity, and for everyone else here for taking the time out and making this happen. Thank you and have a nice day.